will be behave like this, maximum compression force and no tension here, like this. So full section is in compression. How you are going to get the section full compression, that we are going to see now. Okay, so see here, principle of pressing, what happened? If this is the typical beam, okay, which having the dimension B and D, cross section of the beam, and we are going to calculate the stresses, okay, we are going to calculate the stresses on the beam. So how we are going to consider this, how we are going to calculate the stresses? If you are going to consider this is B and this is capital D, and this is neutral axis. If this is neutral axis, okay, first thing, as you people know, we are going to calculate the stresses in any beam. Okay, if beam is subjected with the axial force and when the beam is subjected with the moment, so we have to calculate the stresses. And already you people know, when beam is subjected with the axial force, we are going to calculate the direct stresses. And when beam is subjected with the bending moment, in that case we have to calculate the bending moments. Now see, the beam which you are going to deal here, the cross section of beam we have seen. So if longitudinal section of beam, you can see, so longitudinal section of beam is like this, okay, and in this beam, if you provide the tendon, okay, if you provide the tendon at CG of the beam, okay, if you are going to provide the tendon at CG of the beam, so this is tendon, okay, this is tendon. And now if you are going to, first you are going to apply the force to the tendon, we are going to stretch the tendon, okay, and after stretching this tendon, we are going to cut the tendon, and after cutting the tendon, the reverse action will happen and the force is going to act on this beam like this. So this is P, if you are going to consider, if this is P here, so here in diagram they have mentioned F, so we consider this value as also F. So this is compression force, okay, the compression force F. The compression force F we are going to consider. So first thing, now compression force is going to act on this section, the section of beam, cross section of beam. Here this is a depth and width of beam, okay, so width of beam, so this is cross section, so this is cross section dimension of beam is B by D, so that is area of the beam. So if you want to calculate the direct stresses, okay, so direct stresses due to the pre-stressing force, so these are the direct stresses, direct stresses, okay, and direct stresses is force upon area, so F by A, the area here, A is equal to B into D, okay, so this A is equal to P into D. So this is stresses due to force and area. And second important thing here, the beam is not subjected with only this compression force, okay, the beam is not subjected with the only compression force, the beam is subjected with the self weight and live load, okay, the superimposed load also. So due to live load and superimposed load, the beam is going to bend like this, and this, due to this, the moment will come, and when moment is come, we have to calculate the bending stresses. So whatever these two stresses we have calculated, those stresses are bending stresses. bending stresses. Okay, how to calculate the bending stresses? We know the formula. Okay, so formula to get the bending stresses is nothing but M by Z. Okay, so here, so M, they have considered, they have calculated the two moments. First is moment due to dead load and moment due stress, moment due to live load. Okay, so they have considered the moment as the live load, dead load, consider MD, and moment for live load they have considered ML, ML by Z. Okay, so this they have considered, and Z is equal to, you know, Z is equal to what? Z is a section modulus. Section modulus is equal to I by Y. I by Y. So they have taken Y upside, and they have written the formula like this. They have written the formula like this: MD. MD. Y they have taken upward side, Y divided by I. So like this they have written the formula. Same thing they have done for live load also. So now what will affect here? Due to force, due to compression force, this section, what are the, which stresses are going to develop here? See, both side the compression force is going to act. So this whole section, okay, so this whole beam, which stresses are going to develop? The compression stress are going to develop. So that's why the stress diagram will be like this, and as compression we are going to use plus sign. Okay, so here we are going to use plus sign. And now what happened? Due to dead load, due to dead load at bottom seam, bottom tensile stresses we're going to generate, and at top compression stresses are going to develop. So here due to this, okay, the stresses, dead load, here the minus and this side will be the plus. This side will be the live load, this will be the, sorry, this will be the minus again. This will be the minus. And what we have to do here, whatever the two values here, this is tension, this is tension, this both tension due to bending moment, okay, due to the superimposed load. And already we have introduced the compression force in such a way that here at bottom those counter, those that is the internal stresses we have developed in a planned manner. So these two negative values both will the negative, and if you are going to add this plus, this value becomes zero here. And this compression, this compression, this compression, because top compression here, there are two compressions. So total net stresses, the compression stress is here, and the section. Now you, if you can see the stresses in the section, this beam section, if you are going to see, the section is full in compression. This is main principle of pre-stress concrete. Okay, getting? So once again I will tell you people that important thing, the principle of pre-stressing is this. So you people have to understand this thing, okay, that we are going to introduce the internal stresses in a planned manner. Planned manner means we have to do a calculation, okay, and required amount of force we are going to apply to this beam. So after application of these forces here through the tendon, we are going to calculate whatever the tensile force required here, this tensile stresses required, okay, due to that tension force tensile stresses are going to develop, and these tensile stresses we have to contract due to this by developing the internal stresses in a planned manner. So here no tension in the full section, okay, and if there is no tension, there is no need of reinforcement. And now one more important thing, please pay attention. In RCC member, while what the role of this role of concrete we have ignored, why? Because there is no compression. This section, this part of beam in RCC is in tension, so that's why the contribution of this concrete is neglected. No role of this one. Now see, at this part the concrete, the section is having the compression forces. Now this compression forces is going to carried by this concrete. So we have make this section work fully effective by introducing this compression forces here in this member. Okay, I think you have got the things now. Okay, so next we are going to see. So, and this is case where when pre-stressing force applied at CG, CG means this is tendon, tendon, this green color, we have whatever this here, we have tendon. If you are going to cut this section here, you are going to select like this. And when tendon you are going to provide at center, the force is going to act at a center. Okay, so directly we have considered P by F by A here. Okay, so next thing, principle of pre-stressing again. Now condition is here changed. In rectangular beam, earlier we have provided the tendon at center, but now we are going to provide tendon at with some eccentricity, and that eccentricity is E0. Okay, now what happened due to provision of this eccentricity? Okay, due to provision of this eccentricity, the structure is going to bend like this. Okay, I mean tension forces are going to create. Okay, so sorry, compression forces are going to create. Sorry, so if this is cross section of beam, already we have seen direct stresses F by A. Okay, this is direct stresses due to the force. This force is going to act here, and cross section area of beam. Second thing here, new thing here. What happened earlier? We have seen this two diagram. Live load moment due to movement and dead load moment, the stresses are going to develop. These are the bending stresses. Bending stresses. These are the direct stresses. Direct stresses. And the new stresses is going to generate here. The stresses due to the eccentricity. The stresses due to the eccentricity. And how we are going to consider, how you are going to calculate stress due to eccentricity? See here, if how the stress is going to act, the eccentricity if this is beam. And if I have provided tendon with some eccentricity, not at exactly center, and the tendon is going to apply the force F, okay, here with some eccentricity. And what is eccentricity? Eccentricity is a distance from center of section to the force. To the force. So this is eccentricity. This is eccentricity E. Now what happens if you are going to take the moment at centroid axis? What happens? These two forces are going to move upwards. So moment will be like this. The moment will be like this. And the moment will be like this. Then the section is going to behave like this. Sorry. The section is going to behave like this. Is going to behave like this. Okay, sorry, the section, sorry, the section is going to behave exactly opposite whatever to the moment, dead load and live load. Okay, and that value we are going to consider that force into eccentricity. Okay, that is P into E, that is moment, and divided by Z. I will explain here. Next here. Here I will explain. Wait a minute. Diagram, 1 minute. If you are going to consider centroid axis is here, ok, Okay, this is introduction, not a tendon. And we have provided tendon with some eccentricity here. This is tendon, this is neutral axis or centered axis. This is centered axis, and here this is tendon, and the tendon is going to give the force, going to apply the force on the member. Yeah, with an eccentricity of E0. Now if you are going to consider the movement at centered axis, okay, this is going to bend like this. The beam is going to behave like this. Due to this moment, see F into E, the moment diagram will be like this. And which causes the beam to bend like this? This eccentricity and the force. And these two, this due to movement is created, and that movement is also bending movement, but that bending due to eccentricity. So that value here we are going to consider, that is F into E0 is the moment divided by Z, and they have written this Z into I by Y form. Okay, so this new thing added here. So this section is in compression now. Okay, if you are going to see the eccentricity bottom, here bottom is in compression, and at top there is a tension. And when the when you are going to consider the bending moment due to dead load and live load, at bottom there is a tension and top at compression. So if you are going to add all these things, all stresses, so here is a compression, compression, here is a larger compression, not smaller, higher compression, and this is plus, this is plus, minus and minus, here smaller compression. Okay, but against the stresses, if you are going to see the behavior, the against the stresses in the section, the stresses in the section, again positive, all the compression stresses all is a positive, so there is a no tension. Got it? So if there is a no tension, no tension means there is a no cracks and no steel requirement. Okay, and the aim of this pre-stress concreting is this, that we have to make full use of effective use of concrete which we have provided in a cross section. Okay, so next thing here, now some important things here, that now you got the concept of pre-stress concreting. Just I am going to summarize what is pre-stress concreting over RCC member. The pre-stress concreting member in which we have to remove the tensile stresses in the member, okay, if there is a beam, and we are going to introduce the stresses in a such a planned manner that the all section is the all cross the cross section of beam is in full compression. So if the structure, the section is in full compression, in that case, if section is in full compression, in that case no steel is required, and if no steel is required, no tension is there, there is a no chance of cracks. Okay, so this is simple thing, and for that we have to use direct stresses, we have to use the bending stresses. Direct stresses, simple direct stresses we are going to use to the tendons. So direct stresses we are going to calculate by considering P by A or F by A, and bending stresses M by Z, and here that force into movement by Z, and we have done the, we have to do a calculation. Next 10 to 12 lectures we are going to use only this thing to solve the various problem and calculation of the various stresses at top compression fiber and bottom compression fiber of the cross section of the beam. So now important thing is here, concrete used for pre-stress concrete, okay, work should have a cube strength of for post tensioning system 35 newton per mm square and pre tensioning system 45 newton per mm square. So here are two systems of pre-stress concreting, that is post tension and pre-tension. We are going to see in detail what various methods and types of that systems. So first thing, two methods, that post tension method. Post tension means what? We are going to apply, we are going to give the tension to the tendon, okay, after casting the beam. Okay, we are going to put the some ducts in the beam, and first we are going to fill that concrete, and then we are going to stress the tendon. Such system is called as a post tension system. And pre tension system is that when we are going to cast the beam, initially we are going to stress the tendons and then we are going to fill the concrete in the beam. Such system is called as a pretension system. So minimum cube strength, generally we have, when we have designed the building, okay, RCC public building, in that case we have considered the cube strength that M20, 25, 30, okay. But pre-stressed concreting, it is mandatory that you have to use high strength concrete. Okay, for pretension 35, for post tension 35 and pretension 45 newton mm square minimum. Now high strength concrete is necessary for the following reason. Why there is a need to put high strength concrete? In exam sometimes they are going to ask the question, why there is a need to provide the high strength concrete in a pre-stressed concreting? See, due to high bearing stresses are developed at end by the anchoring devices. What happens here? When you are going to provide we are introducing the compression stresses in the member by applying the force, okay, through the tendon. If this is tendon, when you are going to apply the forces in tendon, okay, first we are going to pull, that we are going to give tension to the tendon, and then we are going to release when you are going to cut, and the force is going to act like this here. So at these junctions, at end of the beam, see here, at the edges of the beam here, the end blocks provided, okay, and anchoring devices are here. Means when you are, the moment you are going to cut the bar here, when the forces which you are applying to the tendon, okay, it going to come reverse, and those are going to transfer to this concrete member. And here, to control these stresses here, the anchoring devices are provided. So due to high bearing stresses are developed at the end by anchoring stress, anchoring devices. So here, to resist these bearing stresses, we require high strength of concrete. Okay, so that's why the high strength of concrete required. This is one reason. Bursting stresses liable to at the end of beam. So what happens immediately when you are going to release, when you are going to cut this tendon, after applying the forces come to reverse, and the huge bursting stresses are going to develop at these edges. Okay, and to control that bursting stresses, we have to provide high strength of concrete. If you are going to provide the low strength concrete, due to bursting, that concrete is going to fail. Okay, so if concrete is going to fail, there is no forces in this tendon, and if no forces in the tendon, this going to be, the beam is going to act as a RCC beam only. Okay, next, to get the high bond strength, to get high bond between this tendon and concrete, okay, to get the bond between these two, we required higher strength concrete to avoid the shrinkage crack. If the concrete strength is higher, the shrinkage crack will be the minimum or lower. Due to high modulus of elasticity, if the concrete grade is high, the modulus of elasticity of concrete is also high. That's why due to high modulus of elasticity is we also required. So that's why we are going to provide the high strength concrete. So required cross sectional of beam will be minimum, and due to this, if we are going to provide the area of the stresses of concrete, we are going to provide higher. In that case, ultimately, when we are going to do a calculation, when we are going to start the design, in that case, ultimately, cross section required will be the minimum. Okay, similar way, as I already have told you, in pre-stressed concrete, we are not going to provide any reinforcement other than the tendon. Tendon are we are going to provide in the form of wires. Wires of having the diameter 2 3 mm, 2 mm, 5 mm, 6 mm diameter wire are used. Okay, and the wires also having the high tensile strength. Generally, when we have designed the any building or RCC member, the stresses for steel we have used Fe 4 and 5 or 500. Okay, but when we are going to deal with the tendon, the stresses it of tendon is like this. The ultimate strength 2100 newton per mm square and initial stress is 1000 newton per mm square. Now why there is a high strength tensile high tensile steel required? This much of tendon stress is required because due to creep and shrinkage of concrete, the net tensile stress is reduced. What happen when we are going to provide the tendon in the concrete due to creep? Okay, due to creep and shrinkage of concrete and the creep. Due to creep and shrinkage, there is a chance of losses. The stress is going to tensile stress in this tendon is going to reduce. Okay, so due to that, we have to provide the high strength steel. Second thing, the estimate of loss pre-stress due to shrinkage of concrete and the creep concrete and steel is nearly 200 newton per mm square. So see, the amount of loss due to this shrinkage and creep is 200. There is other losses also, relaxation loss, and due to other that other losses, if loss is 200 and if you are going to provide the strength of wire 400 or 500 newton, the 50% is the stress is going to loss due to this shrinkage and creep. So to avoid this, the high strength of tendon are required while designing the pre-stress concreting member. Okay, so this thing, just I'm going to summarize this page. The high strength concrete and steel is required for pre-stress concreting system because of these various reasons. Generally here in concrete, to avoid the bursting stresses because large forces we are going to transfer at the edges by cutting the tendon, and for steel there is a chances of losses in the tensile stresses, and to avoid those after considering those losses also we have to provide higher stresses steel. And the last part here today's lecture, that is comparison of pre-stressed concrete beam with the reinforced concrete beam. So what is the comparison, how you are going to compare? So first, if you are going to consider the pre-stressed concrete beam and reinforced concrete beam, so entire section is effective in pre-stressed concrete. Already we have seen whole section is in compression, so each part of concrete is part of the section is going to contribute. RCC member, the concrete beam neutral axis is ineffective, already we have discussed. The pre-stressed concrete beams are lighter. Okay, why lighter? There is no movement, so depth required is less, and RCC beam are generally heavy compared with the pre-stressed concrete member. High strength concrete and steel are necessary, already we have discussed. Now what are the discussed that were due to that various reasons high strength of concrete and steel required. High strength concrete not needed in limit state method. There is no need of high strength concrete because major part we are going to consider in a tension. Okay, so steel is going to take care, and concrete not that high, that high grade strength concrete is required in a RCC. Deflection in the pre-stressed concrete beam are small. Obviously, initially we have planned, we have developed the stresses like that, that there is a counteract between external forces and internal forces, so there is no chance of deflection, and if there is a deflection, the value is very small. And deflection in RCC beam are more. Why? Because we are allowing the tension, we are allowing the cracks, okay, and we have allowing the deflection, so that deflection is more compared to the pre-stressed concrete beam. Construction need the many auxiliary units like pre-stressing equipments and anchoring. As this is new techniques, the new instruments are required, that is pre-stressing equipments means when you are going to provide the tendon, that wire, we have to stress this wire. We have to develop initially forces, we are going to apply the forces and we are going to develop the stresses. So for that, pre-stressing equipments are required, and anchoring unit at end, we have to anchor that bar. So that anchoring things are required. What are the various types of systems based upon anchoring, that we are going to see in next lecture. Construction does not involve any auxiliary units. So this is conventional method, RCC method, there is no auxiliary units are required. Okay, so this is today's lecture in which I have tried to convince you people what is concept of prestressed concrete. Hope you understood. Otherwise, if you are not get anything from this, try again, see the video, and if you have any problem, let me know, contact me. Okay, thank you for patiently listening.